My Name is Mina by David Almond. Read by Charlie Sanderson. Moonlight, wonder, flies and nonsense. My name is Mina and I love the night. Anything seems possible at night when the rest of the world has gone to sleep. It's dark and silent in the house, but if I listen close, I hear the beat, beat, beat of my heart. I hear the creak and crack of the house. I hear my mum breathing gently in her sleep in the room next door. I slip out of bed and sit at the table by the window. I tuck the curtain open. There's a full moon in the middle of the sky. It bathes the world in its silvery light. It shines on Falconer Road and on the houses and the streets beyond and on the city roofs and spires and on the distant mountains and moors. It shines into my room and onto me. Some say that you should turn your face from the light of the moon. They say it makes you mad. I turn my face towards it and I laugh. Make me mad, I whisper. Go on, make Mina mad. I laugh again. Some people think that she's already mad, I think. I look into the night. I see owls and bats that fly and flicker across the moon. Somewhere out there, whisper the cat, is slipping through the shadows. I close my eyes and it's like those creatures are moving inside me, almost like I'm a kind of weird creature myself. A girl whose name is Mina, but more than just a girl whose name is Mina. There's an empty notebook lying on the table in the moonlight. It's been there for an age. I keep on saying that I'll write a journal, so I'll start right here. Right now, I open the book and write the very first words. My name is Mina, and I love the night. Then what shall I write? I can't just write that this happened, then this happened, then this happened, to bore an infinitum. I'll let my journal grow, just like the mind does, just like a tree or a beast does, just like life does. Why should a book tell a tale in a dull straight line? Words should wander and meander. They should fly like owls and flicker like bats and slip like cats. They should murmur and scream and dance and sing. Sometimes there should be no words at all. Just silence. Just clean, white space. Some pages will be like a sky with a single bird in it. Some will be like a sky with a swirling swarm of starlings in it. My sentences will be a clutch, a collection, a pattern, a swarm, a shawl, a mosaic. They will be a circus, a menagerie, a tree, a nest. Because my mind is not in order. My mind is not straight lines. My mind is a clutter and a mess. It is my mind, but it is also very like other minds, and like all minds, like every mind that there has ever been, and every mind that there will ever be, it is a place of wonder. The mind 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 is a place of wonder. When I was at school, at St. Bede's Middle, I was told by my teacher, Mrs. Scullery, that I should not write anything until I planned what I should write. What nonsense! Do I plan a sentence before I speak it? Of course I do not. Does a bird plan its song before it sings? Of course it does not. It opens its beak and it sings. So I will sing. I did want to be what they called a good girl, so I did try. There was one fine morning when the sun was shining through the classroom window. There was a cloud of flies shimmering and dancing in the air outside. I heard Mrs. Scullery telling us that she wanted us to write a story. Of course, we'd need to write a plan first, she said. She asked us whether we understood. We told her that we did. So I stopped staring at the flies, which I had been enjoying very much. And I wrote my plan. My story would have such and such a title and would begin in such and such a way. Then such and such would happen in the middle, then such and such would be the outcome at the end. I wrote it all down very neatly. I showed my plan to Mrs. Scullery and she was very pleased. She even smiled at me and said, "Well done, Mina. That is very good, dear. Now you may write the story." But of course, when I started to write, the story wouldn't keep still, wouldn't it be? The words danced like flies. They flew off in strange and beautiful directions and took my story on a very unexpected course. I was very pleased with it. But when I showed it to Mrs. Scullery, she just got cross. She held the plan in one hand and the story in the other. "They do not match," she said in her screechy voice. "I don't know what you mean, miss," I said. She leaned down towards me. "The story," she said, in a slow, stupid voice, like she was talking to somebody slow and stupid, "does not fit the plan." "But it didn't want to, miss," I answered. "Didn't want to? What on earth do you mean, it didn't want to?" "I mean, it wanted to do other things, miss." She put her hands on her hips and shook her head. "It is a story," she said. "It is your story. It will do what you tell it to." "But it won't," I said. She kept on glaring at me. "And miss," I said, like I was pleading with her to understand, "I don't want it to, miss." I should have saved my breath. She flung the papers onto my table. "This is typical of you," she said. "Absolutely typical." And she turned to a girl called Samantha and asked her to read her tale, which was something about a girl with curly hair and a cuddly cat. A perfectly planned, idiotic thing in which nothing interesting happened at all. And of course, all the other kids were giggling through it all. And it led to one of the nicknames I had back then. Typical. Absolutely typical, McKee. Typical. My stories were like me. They couldn't be controlled and they couldn't fit in. Trying to be a good girl sometimes made me very sad. The end of it all was the day I became nonsensical. Fantastically nonsensical. I'll tell the story of that day when the time seems right, when the words seem right. And I suppose I'll tell the other tales that matter, like the tale of my day at Corinthian Avenue and my vision, or the story of my journey to the underworld in Heston Park, or the story of my grandfather's house and the owls. And I'll put in poems and scribblings and nonsense. Sometimes writing nonsense can make a lot of sense. That sounds nonsensical itself, of course, but it isn't. Nonsensical. What a great word. Wow. Nonsensical. Now I've started. It's lovely to see the empty pages that stretch before me. Writing will be like a journey. Every word a footstep that takes me further into an undiscovered land. Look at the way the words move across the page and fill the empty spaces. Did God feel like this when he started to fill the emptiness? Is there a God? Was there ever emptiness? I don't know. But it doesn't stop me wondering and wondering. Wondering and wondering are almost the same word. And wandering through space is very like wandering inside the head. I'm a wanderer and a wonderer. Sometimes I look at the world and I'm amazed that there's anything at all. Why is there anything? Why is there something rather than nothing? Why? And before there was something, was there just nothing? And did that nothing turn into something? And if that nothing turned into something, how did it do it? And why? My motto's written on paper and pinned above my bed. How can a bird that is born for joy sit in a cage and sing? It's by William Blake. Blake the misfit. Blake the outsider. Just like me. He was a painter and a poet, and some people said he was mad, just like they say about me. Maybe he was out too much in the moon. Sometimes he wore no clothes. Sometimes he saw angels in his garden. He saw spirits all around him. I think he was very sane. So does my mum. So did my dad. I will write with William Blake in mind. I will write about the sad things, of course, because there is no way not to write about the sad things. And there are sad things in my life. Well, one big, sad and horrible thing. Weirdly enough, the sad things in my life make the happy things seem more intense. I wonder if other people feel like that. If they feel that sadness, in a weird way, can help to make you more intensely happy. That's what's known as a paradox, I suppose. Paradox. What a word. It sounds good, looks good, and the meaning's good. And if something is a paradox, it is paradoxical, which is an even better word. Paradoxical. That's the kind of nickname I'd like to have. Not typical McKee, but paradoxical McKee. Or nonsensical McKee, of course. Anyway, I'll try to make my words break out of the cages of sadness and make them sing for joy. Suddenly, thinking about the one big sad and horrible thing, I know that I'm writing all this for Dad. I imagine him watching me and reading my words as I write. He'll be everywhere in this journal, of course, in my mind and in my words, and moving among the spaces between the words and behind the words. Sometimes I tell people that he died before I was born, but that isn't true. And I do have some memories of him. I'll write of those. I think of him watching from somewhere far away beyond the moon. Hello, Dad. Yes, I think I'm happy now. Yes, I think Mum is too. Good night. I slip back into bed. The maddening moon shines down on me. I've started the journal at last. Tomorrow, I'll write some more. Now, I'll try to dream of bats and cats and owls. Bananas, weirdos, a beautiful tree and boring heaven. Had breakfast with Mum. Bananas and yoghurt and toast with marmalade. Delicious. I told her I'd started my journal. Excellent, she said. I said I might show some of the pages when I'm ready. Excellent, she said. She said maybe we could make some clay models today. Excellent, I said. Then I came out of the house and climbed into my tree. and here I am. I love my tree. I've been climbing it for a couple of years. I shin up the trunk to a branch that's just a bit higher than my head. I sit here astride the branch with my back against the trunk. Sometimes I let my legs dangle. Sometimes I sit with my knees raised so that I can rest a book on them. It's very comfortable, like it was made for me. I've been known to sit here for hours at a time, drawing or reading, or just thinking and looking and listening and wondering. It's early spring. A pair of blackbirds are building a nest, not too far away from me. The nest's almost done. I know that because I sometimes climb higher and look down into it. One day soon, I look down and see eggs in there. Then I see chicks. Then I'll see fledglings leaving the nest. Then I'll see the fledglings become birds that fly into the blue, blue yonder. How amazing is that? The blackbirds squawk alarm calls when I climb higher, like they're yelling, "Behave yourself! Squawk! Get back down, girl! Squawk!" But I don't think they're really too troubled by me. Not like they would be by a cat, for instance, or by a stranger. Maybe they think I'm some kind of weird bird myself, or some kind of peculiar branch. Maybe if I sat very still for a very long time, they'd build a nest in me, in my lap, or in my hair, or in my hands if I raised them up and cupped them. There is a story about this, called St. Kevin and the Blackbird. St. Kevin and the Blackbird. Long ago, there was a saint called Kevin who lived in Ireland. One day, he was praying with his hands stretched towards heaven, or what he thought was heaven, when a blackbird flew down and laid an egg in his hands. St. Kevin was a good man, and he didn't want to break the egg or prevent it from hatching. And, being a saint, he also probably thought that the egg was a gift from God. So, he stayed in exactly the same position for day after day and night after night, with his hands stretched towards heaven, or what he thought was heaven, until the egg hatched right there in his hands. Imagine that! A tiny chick making its first movements in your hands. Imagine the claws, the wet wings, the cheep, cheep, cheep. Imagine it growing as you cared for it. And imagine it flying away. Some of the kids from St. Bede's passed by the end of the street a few moments back. They saw me, but they've stopped laughing and calling by now. These days they just roll their eyes and whisper a few words to each other and head on to the gates of their cage. That's if they do anything at all. They used to call me a witch and a weirdo. They yelled I was a monkey and a crow. Oh, they had great fun last year. In the summer they threw daisies and yelled, "Daisies for Miss Crazy!" In the autumn they threw conkers and yelled, "Conkers for Miss Bonkers!" Which is quite amusing when you think about it, I suppose. Now I'm just part of the scenery, like I am for the birds. I am like a lamppost or a tree or a stone. I don't care. They're nothing to me. I don't even look at them. Them. Huh. Huh. Nothing. This is Falconer Road. It's a narrow street of terraced houses with little front gardens, each garden with a single tree in it, like this one. The houses are perhaps 80 years old. There are back lanes and garages behind the houses. Beyond the end of the street is Crow Road, where the bigger, older houses are. I own a house there, or I will when I'm grown up. It's a bit dilapidated and has extraordinary creatures living in it. Thank you, Grandpa. I raise my eyes to the sky. Thank you, Grandpa. He left it to me in his will. He's another one that's dead. We say he's in heaven with Dad. Heaven. I used to think that the idea of heaven was silly. I used to think of all the people who keep on dying. Heaven must get ridiculously full, I thought. There wouldn't be room anywhere in the universe for it. How big is heaven? I said to Mum one day when I was small. I'd just seen a hearse with a coffin in it heading past the end of the street to the massive cemetery on Jesmond Road, the one where Dad's buried. Oh, very, very big, I should think, she said. I thought of all the cemeteries in all the world. I thought of all the people lying in them. I thought of all the people who have lived and died in the years and years and years of time. I just couldn't imagine it. It must be ginormous, I said. Yes, I suppose so, she said. Then, a few weeks later, we were reading an encyclopedia. It said that if you counted all the people who had ever lived in all the history of the world until about 50 years ago, there wouldn't be as many as the people who are alive today. Extraordinary fact. There are as many people alive in the world today as there have been in the whole of human history. That surprised us a great deal. It was a couple of hours later that I realised what that meant. So that means, I said, that heaven only needs to be about as big as the earth. Yes, she said. I suppose that's true. And we laughed about it, because compared with the size of the universe, earth isn't very big at all. And even earth isn't full. There's room for lots more bodies. Just like in heaven, there's room for lots more souls. These days, though, I don't believe any of that. I think that the idea of heaven is silly for other reasons. When people try to say what heaven is like, it just sounds deadly, deadly, deadly dull. Standing around, singing and eating nectar or something, and looking at God and praising Him and being very, very, very good. Imagine that. Yawn, 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 yawn. Who'd want to do that for century after century after century after century? Somebody like Mrs. Scullery, maybe, but not me. I bet that even the angels get fed up with it all. I bet they want to eat bananas and marmalade and chocolate and to look at things like clouds of flies and to climb trees or to play with cats. I bet they look at us and envy us for being human. I bet that sometimes they even want to be like us. Except they might get put off by the fact that we die. Anyway, in the end, I don't really believe in heaven at all, and I don't believe in perfect angels. I think that this might be the only heaven there can possibly be. This world we live in now, but we haven't quite realised it yet. And I think that the only possible angels might be us. This might be heaven. We might be living in heaven right now, and we might be the angels. Is that stupid? No, it's not. Look at the blackbird. The way the sunlight glistens on it. Look at the way it shimmers. The way its blackness glints with silver, purple, green, and even white beneath the sun. Listen to its song. Look at the way it jumps into the sky. Look how the leaves are coming out from the buds. Feel how strong the tree is. And feel the beat of my heart, and the sun on my skin and the air on my cheek. Think of things like the human voice, the solar system, the fur of a cat, the sea, bananas, a duck-billed platypus. Look at the things that we've made, Houses and pavements and walls and steeples and roads and cars and songs and poems. And yes, I know that it's a long, long way from being perfect. But perfection would be very dull. And perfection isn't the point. Perfection is boring. Perfection is empty. Perfection is nothingness. Look at the world. Smell it. Taste it. Listen to it. Feel it. Look at it. Look at it. And I know horrible things happen for no good reason. Why did my dad die? What's the point of famine and fear and darkness and war? I don't know. I'm just a kid. How can I know answers to things like that? But this horrible world is so blooming beautiful and so blooming weird that sometimes I think it'll make me faint. Just look at the mind-blowing, lip-smacking, wonderful, amazing, beautiful, stunning, marvellous, gorgeous, lovely loveliness of our world. Mina! Calls Mum. Mina! Coming, Mum! I don't move. There's a white van at Mr. Meyer's house, just along the street. He died. Another one. It's about time we had some people born around here. He was called Ernie, and he was very old. He used to stand at his window staring out, and even when you smiled and waved at him, you couldn't be certain if he'd seen you or if he thought he was dreaming about you. I used to wonder what was going on inside his brain. Did he see the same things as everybody else? Or did he see different things? Did he see nothing at all? Did the world and me and everybody in it seem like a dream? And come to that, do any of us see what another person sees? Maybe we're all living in some strange kind of dream. If we are, of course, we wouldn't know that we are. I used to see a doctor going into the house sometimes. He was a miserable-looking grey kind of bloke that came in a miserable-looking grey kind of car. He caught sight of me in the tree one day. I started to wave, but he just scowled. Like he thought that sitting in a tree was the stupidest thing in the whole wide world. It was obviously far too much of a struggle for somebody like him to smile and wave back at somebody like me. Huh. Wouldn't want him to be my doctor. He'd make you feel like topping yourself just by looking at you. Can't have been much of a doctor anyway. Mr. Myers died and was dead for nearly a week before they found him, lying under the table in the kitchen. Poor soul. He had a daughter, but I don't think she ever really cared for him. She's at the house right now, carrying out some of Mr. Meyer's belongings to the van. She's another streak of misery. She was like that even when Ernie was alive. Maybe she thought he'd have some gold hidden away, rather than old table lamps and worn rugs and tatty chairs that she's carrying out now. Mum says the place is full of stuff, piled up in the attic and in the dilapidated garage at the back of the house. Look at her, misery guts. You had him until he was old. You had your dad till he was old, and you didn't care. The streak of misery's putting Mr. Meyer's house up for sale. Wonder who'll buy it? Mina! Yes, Mum? Mina! Listen to how lovely her voice is. Call again, Mum. Mina! Wow. Yes, Mum? Dinosaurs, French toast and a journey in the underworld.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.